commercial airline pilot with a background in engineering, and Emily Mailhot, an undergraduate in astrophysics at Lehigh University. For the last 20 years, from Allen's home observatory in Northwest New Jersey, home of the NWJAA Astronomy Club, has been used for activities including personal observing, public outreach, and data collection supporting ongoing professional research. Due to increasing visits by school groups and local astronomy clubs, what began as a private observatory located on the roof of his home, what a burden, has evolved over time into a facility that can accommodate large crowds during public nights. Currently, their 25-inch Newtonian is housed in a separate roll-off building and, in addition to public outreach, is utilized in numerous data collection activities that support ongoing research programs at institutions such as MIT and Wesley College and others. Al Mitkiff has been a member of AAI for, we were trying to guess, 2001, 2002, somewhere in that range. Prominent local New Jersey observatory observer. I have not had the privilege of getting out to his 25-inch out of his home yet. Travesty of mine, but I'll get out there eventually, Al, I promise. But, you know, I asked Al, I sent Al an email, I was like, can you and Emily come and talk at a monthly meeting for us at Sparrow? He goes, I know what you get, we're not good enough. I'm like, what do you mean you're not good enough? You know, you built an observatory on top of your house to put a 25-inch in to do professional-level research on an amateur-ish budget with amateur available equipment. And a telescope that's in the same size class as what we have here at Sperry. What could be more inspiring to our members than to see one of our own doing on his own what we can do at Sperry with our own equipment? Maybe we'll inspire more of our members to become more of an active in the research committee. He said, Aaron, you're a great salesman, I'll do it. So without any further ado, Alan Mitkiff and Emily Mailhot.
All right, well, I want to start off by thanking you for allowing us to come here and talk about the kind of work we're doing out at our observatory. Like Aaron mentioned, I was a little bit hesitant at first, but of course he's a great salesman. And in light of the recent work with the exoplanets, it's actually become more relevant. So, two parts tonight. I'll do the first part, and Emily will finish up in the second. I'll talk mostly about the hardware, construction of the different observatories, and the development. I'll do a brief talk about the solar instrumentation, and then Emily will discuss the science and our collaborative efforts with different organizations and universities. And she'll actually finish the talk discussing the KELT exoplanet program, which is once again relevant here, and especially for Mary Lou, Jim, Tolka, and Cliff, who are also members of the follow-up network. So between 8th and 9th grade, I spent the summer working baling hay, and I finally was able to save up for an 8-inch telescope. In the spring of that year, my dad and I, we built a platform for it. I spent many early mornings carrying the entire assembly out to view Comet West, which was had a very nice apparition. But from that point on, I really wanted a permanently mounted observatory with a permanently mounted telescope. Finally, in the summer of that year, we added a central pier to take care of some of the vibration issues, which is kind of an introduction to me to the kind of issues that you have to deal with when you're trying to build an observatory or a telescope. So fast forward 20 years, acquired a 31-acre lot on a hilltop in Frelinghuysen. At that point, it was just fields, so we were obviously planning on building a residence there. And since we were starting from scratch, we could design any house we wanted. And since I had always wanted a permanent observatory, I thought, well, this could be a chance to try to co-locate one with the house. And of course, when you co-locate living space with an observatory, they're kind of conflicting. With an observatory, you want it to be cold and dark, and a house warm and well lit. So the stated objective was to construct an astronomy facility integrated with family living space that could be isolated from the effects of normal household activities, yet allow for a complete setup in under 10 minutes. We chose a roll-off roof design because I wanted more than one telescope, a short focus reflector for deep sky and a longer focus refractor for planets and double stars and whatnot. And I also wanted to be able to access an open sky view from inside the building without having to go out. So some of the design factors when you're trying to do something like this, of course you have the thermal issues with a warm house. And in this case, since the observatory was on the top of the building, it was really important to put a high level of insulation in the roof. We also used as light as shingles as possible to minimize the re-radiation effects. And then, you know, just to have a telescope on the roof of a building, any movement within the building itself would couple and transmit to the telescope and cause all kinds of vibrations. So we ended up planning and designing a 30-foot high concrete block tower through the middle of the building and having framing mechanically isolated so the telescopes would sit on top of this tower. And finally, in terms of accessibility, as stated earlier, I wanted the observatory accessible from the living area without having to go outside. And occasionally, we would have to go out and clean the snow off the rails, but often that would just melt on its own. And the tower, the 30-foot tower, is capped with two piers to accommodate both the telescopes. So the observatory is located in the highest part of the house, which is about 20 feet above ground level. This also had the added benefit of minimizing dew formation and mosquitoes. We've got very few mosquitoes and bugs up there. And finally, I did put switches in for a floodlight override so I could keep the lights, exterior lights, turned off in case somebody was going to turn them on when I didn't want them on. And later on, when the house was tied into my photovoltaic system, I ran the observatory circuits off of the inverter, so I had a constant power feed with the battery backup. So we finally broke ground in June of 95, and in this picture you can see these are the regular footings for the house. We're pouring concrete here. This is actually the footing for the pad for the observatory. There's the rebar mat that went in. 7-foot by 4-foot tower runs all the way up through the house. This picture was taken basically when the framing was done, but before any utility stuff was put in. These are some frame grabs. I didn't really take any still shots in. I was kind of frazzled just by building the house, but I did a lot of video. So these are some frame grabs. You can see the decking and the tower coming up to the middle of the building. The building department had no clue what it was. They thought it was a chimney for the heating system. And so it was kind of a don't ask, don't tell situation. I didn't really get a good shot of the slab. You can see the form for the slab here that capped the tower. And this is a closet that I put in later on to hold some of the equipment. This is the observatory office. This is kind of what it looks like now. It's right below the rooftop observatory, but you can kind of see how the tower comes through the building and how the framing is isolated. And we did insulate the tower against the framing through the internal part of the building. So the tower is capped by this 10-foot by 7-foot by 4-inch slab, and the piers themselves are monolithic. They were poured as part of the slab. We ran conduit for the AC/DC and the data. And to get to these conduits, you use access panels that are in the observatory office on the floor below. These are just some shots of the roll-off roof after it was completed, so you can get an idea. Here's some rails. We had to reinforce the framing underneath in the attic area below that. It's all stainless steel channel. I had custom fabricated for the wheel size of the wheels. Here's an aerial shot. You can see the roof roll back. And this is some shots later on when the 25-inch was put in place. Here's a winter shot. You can see how the rails, most of the time, like I said, unless it was a real heavy snow, it would melt off. And because it was the top of a hill, it would blow off. Yes, Wayne?
Having recently dealt with building inspectors, what did the building inspector say about the roll-off roof?
He never, and I was keeping my fingers crossed, he never went up.
That's great.
Yeah, he never went up. We were actually having a hard time getting our well test approved, and we just kind of concentrate on that, but I was just waiting. And the other thing is that we actually switched building inspectors mid-construction. So I was going to say, well, the other guy said it was all right.
You know? Never had to get that for.
No, he never went up. So, yeah, he's been up there many times with all the projects, and he just doesn't ask too many questions anymore. So even before the house was finished, you know, as soon as the roof was able to roll back, I brought my old 8-inch from when I was a kid and set it up on the north pier. I did that until the refractor was delivered. Shortly thereafter, I purchased from Roger Tuthill a 16-inch reflector, and I used JMI push-to encoders that would talk to the sky for pointing. Finally, I took delivery of the 7-inch APO fluorite refractor. This was a one-of-a-kind telescope. We used Aries optics and parallax instruments, built the tube assembly, and they also used an astrophysics focuser. These are some other shots of the of the refractor, the 7-inch. It was a triplet oil space. It was really, really a nice instrument, especially for planetary viewing. So the first public observing, which I really didn't anticipate, was Comet Haikutake in early spring of 96. The house was only framed out at the time. There was no service, no power. I ended up having to drive my truck up to the back door and run an extension from my cigarette lighter up to power the 16-inch drive. The 8-inch had no, didn't take any power. But I had 30 people packed in that 13 by 11 foot room, which was kind of a jammed situation, but it just let me realize that I failed to include the public participation in the design of the observatory. So how did we do with our design objectives? Well, thermal was actually pretty good. The tower does wick some heat from the basement in the living space, such that in cold weather you do have to roll the roof back about an hour before observing. That would be a worst case scenario. And on summer days it did get hot up there, but I installed an air conditioner so I could pre-cool it as long as I knew I was going to be observing that night. And the air mesh over the singles, shingles was quite stable. On the other hand, the vibration, I kind of had a brain dump. I don't know what I was thinking. We spent all that effort running this tower up 30 foot up through the building, and I did not isolate the slab from the pier. So as soon as you stepped from the framing onto the pier, it shook the telescope. So it was an easy fix. We just spanned the whole floor with tongue and groove 2x6s, and that solved the problem. So in 1998, I took delivery of a 25-inch NTT. I sold the 16-inch and 7-inch to cover the cost. I was on the phone with Jim from Jim's Mobile about a focuser, encoders or something, and I noticed in his catalog he was advertising these NTT telescopes. And he told me about he was having difficulty with them. Up to that point, they had just really manufactured these 18-inch split rings as their top of the line. And he was foraying into Alt-Az mountings, and he wasn't getting this one to work. So I said, well, I'll take it and try it, and he gave me a $10,000 discount, and but with no, at the point, no drive controller. So there were two NTTs available at the time, and by the way, NTT, it means that the telescope is folded. You can see it has a 9-inch flat here. His goal was to try to bring the eyepiece at basically standing level so you wouldn't have to climb a ladder. But two NTTs were available. Thomas Bopp got the first one, and he had priority, so he took his delivery, but during the delay, they found a Vixen drive system that worked okay. I mean, it wouldn't talk to the sky, and the gear ratio was kind of low. You can see in the picture here, but it actually tracked it. The telescope would track okay, and the pointing was adequate. So my intention was to unfold the scope right from the get-go. I didn't like the idea of having the 9-inch secondary, both from a collimation standpoint and from a contrast standpoint. So I ended up he sent me extra truss rods and an extra upper cage. And I flipped the tertiary around, it became the diagonal secondary, and he did have some extra truss rods that he was using for testing other equipment he shipped with it. The downside is now when you unfolded this telescope, it has a 122-inch focal length in this small room, so now you could no longer access the full sky. And I finally was able to fix the drive control system. In 2004, I purchased a system from Comsoft. Comsoft was a company run by a gentleman by the name of Dave Harvey, and he worked for the University of Arizona and had designed telescope control systems for many of their major observatories. And he also designed a PC version that you could use to control both Alt-Az and EQ telescopes. It was a DOS-based program. You can kind of see it here. It was pull-down menus and whatnot. It was so small that I could actually call him up and he could modify and email me the complete program with the changes in it. The other downside is it required Windows 98 or earlier because it used the ISA cards to drive the stepper motors. So I stocked up on as many Windows 98 computers as I could before they all went away. It interfaced very well with the sky. And this first system used two-phase stepper motors. The stepper motors had no encoders. Basically, the program would just count how many steps there were between objects and a step rate for tracking between the two axes. But if the motor stalled, if there were any reason it got confused or lost, you had to resync the telescope and start from scratch. So a few years later, I upgraded to a five-phase stepper motor, and that was nice because it had encoder feedback on the motors, and you could also do T-point pointing modeling with it. Built a custom rack mount PC for me, and it included GPS clock updating. So when you do Alt-Az pointing and tracking, you really need an accurate clock in the system to do the transformation between Alt-Az and RA deck. He also gave me an extra warm room paddle so you can control the telescope from the office below. While I had the telescope apart, I had Ed Byers send me a pair of worm wheels and worm gears, and I brought it to a machinist who was a later to be a club member up in Sparta, and he installed the buyer's gears into the drive system. He also added this oversized center bearing so I could pass cables through and not worry so much about cord wrap. Finally, the other thing that we did is we upgraded the truss rods to a much larger diameter to try to minimize some of the flexure. So this is kind of what the telescope looked like in its final state on the rooftop. This is about taken about 2008. And once again, you know, the two main shortcomings were that you couldn't point it the entire part of the sky, especially to the west. That's the Delaware Water Gap out here, actually, so it's west. And the other thing is when you got any more than 10 or 12 people up there, it was kind of crazy observing. You were always yelling duck every time you went and slew the telescope from one target to another. So in 1996, I started attending UACNJ meetings, and in 2004, Barry Malpass asked me to assume the membership duties, which actually Chris Cowley has now. The way, most of you probably know this, but for those who you don't, the UACNJ, United Club, Astronomy Clubs of New Jersey, is an umbrella organization whose members are member clubs in the tri-state area. So to be a observer at UACNJ, you have to belong to one of the member clubs that feeds observers into the club. So, and all the other membership, at least before my time, all the other membership chairs had to go through the same thing, where if you had somebody local to the Northwest Jersey area that wanted to join Jenny Jump, is what they called it, you had to refer them to another club. And the two clubs were this club, AI, or NJAA. And at that point, also the observer count, fuel prices and gas prices were going up, so the observer count had been decreasing over the past couple of years. So finally in 2006, after about my eighth referral, I was on the phone with a gentleman from Sparta who really wanted to join. And I had been thinking about the idea of maybe just starting a virtual club whose sole purpose would be to feed observers into UACNJ and try to stop this decreasing membership count. So I talked to Ron Russo, who was the credentials chairman at UACNJ, and we figured out what the bylaws had to be and the meeting requirements. And we formed the NWJAA, Northwest Jersey Amateur Astronomers. To become a member, you just basically add your name to an email list that Gil's wife, Diane, maintains. And there's no fees or membership cards. But shortly even after forming that group, a lot of the people who were already on the list actually wanted to meet for actual observing. So with Gil Jeffers' help, it became a real club with actual meetings. We meet on my Waseguin property 6 or 7 times a year with a speaker. Many of you in the audience have actually been out there as speakers, and we do greatly appreciate that, driving all the way out to basically oblivion to come give our talks. On clear nights, we do observing through the 25-inch, and the not-so-clear nights, we're entertained by the Bobcats. So about that time in 2007, the physics teacher at the local high school, the one that Emily and I graduated from, he approached me because he had come up with a syllabus for an astronomy course that he was trying to get the Board of Education to sign off on. And Frank had been out to the house a number of times with his earth science class observing, and the gifted and talented group had also been out. And he asked me to help present the curricula of the course, actually, to the Board of Education. And during the course of discussion, we came across the idea of possibly starting an astronomy club for the students that would actually act as the after-school vehicle for observing. So what happens is the students come out to the club meetings and they get extra credit for showing up, but it's not mandatory they show up. And those of you who know Terry Bellies from Voorhees High School, she was a really big help in getting the club started. So the Northwest Regional Astronomy Club, we meet once a month during the school year, and the night that NWJAA has club nights, they meet with the same club. And some of you might recognize this young lady here who is the speaker for the second half of our meeting tonight. So in order to keep the school board attorney at peace, he was bothered by the fact that the school was sending an official, as an official function, sending groups out to a private residence. So with Wayne Augenstein's help, I formed the Starview Hill Education Center. It's a 501c3 nonprofit, and both clubs operate under the auspices of the nonprofit. So most of you have probably heard of the Haystack Radio Observatory in North Central Massachusetts, run by MIT. They also have an optical observatory there called the Wallace Astrophysical Observatory, and it's located on the same hill as Haystack. It's operated by the MIT Planetary Astronomy Lab, which is part of the Department of Earth, Atmospheric, and Planetary Sciences. At the time, it was run by Professor Jim Elliott, who has since passed on, But some of Jim's major achievements were he discovered the rings of Uranus using the Airborne Observatory, and he also discovered Pluto's atmosphere, and actually the two-phase atmosphere that Pluto has that was confirmed by Horizons. So I was perusing the Sky and Telescope, the adverts in the back of the magazine one month, and I noticed that there was this ad in there about a job opportunity for a site manager. So I had been already employed by MIT as a research engineer for at least a dozen years, and I thought it might be interesting actually to try the work if they would let me have at it, you know, albeit while flying. So Jim had this long list of projects he needed to be complete. They had gone a while without an observatory site manager because the predecessor had quit due to too many spiders. So Jim gave me a chance to see if I could actually pull off flying full time. I was still based in New York and then working at this observatory in North Central Mass 40 hours a week. Mike Person is actually the current observatory director now. He took Jim's place. So some of the projects I did there is I converted one of their 70s era Ealing side EQ mounted telescopes to go to. And I did this by actually bringing up my two-phase system I had on my 25 inch, and I converted it with a belt system, which was a very low cost conversion that pleased them quite a bit. Some of the other stuff is I helped them, or Chris wouldn't believe this, but I actually helped them network their observatory so that could be used remotely from campus or from the observatory office. Some other things, I installed and tested a lot of imagers and filter wheels, and I assisted the class and the students with their observing runs and gave the TAs instruction. Helped prep the 24-inch for reilluminization, which took place just about the time I was leaving. And then one of the other last things I did is I installed an auto-guided spectrograph on the 16-inch. But after about a year, I was having just too many conflicts with the flying job, so one of the jobs had to go. I ended up leaving the Wallace Observatory under very good circumstances. I actually got my old job in AeroAstro back, where I'm still working part-time. And I continued to do Pluto asteroid occultation timings from my rooftop observatory. And MIT has this about 12 of these mobile imaging setups, includes a camera and a notebook computer they can send out to different observatories around the world to try to place the telescopes under the shadow paths of occulting asteroids. So about this time, Emily started assisting me with instrument upgrades. She had been very interested in astronomy research. She had been attending the NWJA meeting since she was age 10, and there she is in her first meeting with her riding boots and whatnot, coming from her horseback riding lesson. So some of the goals for the field observatory, one was to have, of course, access to the full sky, and the other one was to be able to accommodate large groups. So I thought we would try something different. Instead of just having the roof roll off, we would roll the whole building, which would make it give the effect that this observatory was just out in the middle of a field, accessible from pretty much everywhere. And also by putting it out in the middle of a field, we would have much more control over glare and light sources and heat sources. So the building ended up being a 20 by 16 roll-off building. We also want a room to possibly have a future larger domed facility. So I have a hay field, a 6-acre hay field to the west of the house. That became the logical source, choice of site. It's a field on the peak of a hill at 750 feet. There's a nice low tree line, 360 degrees all the way around. The center of the field where the observatory was going to be is 400 foot from the house. And we did some site tests out there, and the air seemed very stable over the hay. But there was lots of wildlife, but no running around, free-range bobcats. So this is an aerial shot to show you where the observatory is in reference to the house. The old observatory was on the roof here. The photovoltaic line is east-west, so you can see the north-south is just about on this line here. The observatory is slightly offset because the domed observatory would go right next to it here. And somehow I lost my picture here. Let me see if I can get it back. Nope, it's gone. Anyway, this picture, which has been up here in other talks. In 2012, we dug a 400-foot trench to carry the service out, which included power, water, and data. We decided to use a mostly framed building to try to minimize, as opposed to concrete, to try to minimize the amount of heat sink that would go on during the day. As far as a pier concerned, there's no bedrock out in this field. It's just really just topsoil and clay. What we ended up doing is sinking 6x6s, 4 feet in the ground, surrounding them by concrete. And I wanted to try to match the footprint for both the 25-inch and my 4-inch Unitron that I had in case I wanted to swap telescopes someday. And of course, we ran conduit up the center for data and power, and that could line up with the center bearing on the 25-inch. We decked it with 3/4-inch treated plywood, and here's a part of the rail system. So 1/8-inch aluminum rail for the wheels. I ended up getting 10-inch wheels from McMaster Car. That same CNC business, the machining business, they built the rail mounts for me. 6 wheels total. You can see how it was framed on the building. These are just some shots of the framing as the building went up. We used 2x2 internally braced members in there. We wanted to try to keep the building as light as possible, but it turns out it ended up being too heavy anyway, so that it couldn't be rolled off by hand. Sided with T111. Here is Emily finishing up the painting, and Emily and her dad displaying the observatory without the telescope. To open and close it, ended up getting a couple of power winches from Tractor Supply that we had to modify for cable length and for control. It takes less than a minute to open the building. And finally, in the corner, a warm box for the control computer. So on August of 2012, was moving day for the telescope. The upper left is a shot of Gil and Chris figuring out the pinout for the umbilical cable, which had to be completely taken apart so it could be pulled back through the bearing and set back through and repinned. And with all the pins they had, maybe 25 or 30, they didn't miss one of them. So finally, in September, we had the telescope fully up and running, and at our NWJA meeting for the year, we had our first public night with it. In terms of control software, it's pretty much the same software that we used when it was in the rooftop, except we upgraded to Sky 10. But at that point, the TCS program was starting to have some issues. Also, MIT loaned us permanently, so to speak, one of their travel system to use the camera and the notebook computer. I'll talk a little bit more about that later. We installed a derotator. Anytime you're going to image any particular length, actually anything over really 30 seconds on an ALTAS mount, you need to do something about the field of rotation. So the derotator takes care of that, and it also maintains a north-up image. Chris, in 2013, networked the entire property, so we could actually control the telescope now from inside the house, and once it was on target, you wouldn't have to stay out there and monitor it. You can do it all from inside. He also installed a weather station and an IR video monitor so we could keep track of, at least visually, what the telescope was doing. So how do we make out? Really only minor issues. I underestimated the loading of the end wall, so I ended up just having to size up the wheels. But we did get a lot of dew out in the middle of the field. So I pulled out my old Roger Tuthill Telrad dew shield, and then turns out the dew also made the floor quite slippery, so we painted it with traction paint, and that seemed to take care of it. Winter was another matter, though. Having ground rails is nice for accommodating the crowds, but you can imagine getting snow and ice and stones kicked up on them, and the building trying to run back and forth, and the wheels jamming would rack the building, and it wouldn't open and close properly. So that summer, with the help of a lot of club members, we poured a concrete apron around the building, which took care of the stone problem and also allowed it much easier to keep the area around the building shoveled and clear. We made some rail cover boxes that open. They actually just tip and tilt to expose the rails, but they keep snow from accumulating on the rails and ice. And we did add a skirt system around the bottom of the building to keep snow from blowing under the wall. So shortly after the telescope move, we really started having quite a few problems with the TCS drive system. And the designer had passed away, so the system was basically unsupported. And we decided to go with a serial technology servo system. So instead of the stepper motors, we used DC servo motors. And they also had built-in encoders. SciTech also has a very nice 16-term all-sky automatic plate solve pointing calibration, which produced a model that allows the telescope to track and point fairly accurately. And finally, instead of having 3 or 4 different computers out there, Chris helped me pick out a Windows 7 computer that had enough capacity to do all the scope control, focusing, derotation, imaging, and later running the scripts. So the NTT telescope, as nice as it was really not designed for high precision data collection. There's a lot of flexure and play here and there in the bearings. So in order to try to minimize as much of that, I installed Renishaw high-resolution axes encoders. There's a reed head right here, and the encoder ring is here. And by putting encoders actually on the axes, pretty much as close to the movement of the telescope as possible, you eliminate the errors that's brought in by the gearing system and the motors. So you're really sensing the position of the telescope at the last possible location. These encoders are 31 million ticks per revolution, which, like on paper, gives you sub-arc second pointing, but in the real world, we ended up with 2 or 3 arc minute RMS pointing. And the SciTech cascade mode actually will take both the encoder, the motor encoder positions and the scope encoder positions and constantly compare the two, and of course it gives a preference to the scope encoder positions. So we had tried numerous ways to auto-guide this telescope, but you know, between the flexure between the tub where the auto-guider was and where the camera was and trying to rotate, it just didn't work out all that well. We even tried to do off-axis guiding, and that worked a little bit better, but it was always tough to find a guide star. And you know, anytime you're trying to use a classic Newtonian for imaging, you always have a back focus problem. So any back focus we used up with our derotator, such that we don't even have enough room for a filter wheel. So we decided to write a visual basic script, which does all, not only does all plate solving between exposures, but it also takes care of the derotation within exposures and zeroes out the north angle after every frame is taken. And the other nice thing about running a script is that you can basically point it to where you want in the sky, tell it how many exposures you want to take, you know, length of the exposures, whatnot, and then get it going, and then go to sleep. And because it was doing plate solves between the exposures, even if clouds came in and you lost 15 or 20 minutes, once the sky came back, it would pick up right where it left off and keep going. So in 2013, we applied for our Minor Planet Observatory code. We used Brian Warner's MPO Canopus software, which we also use for our asteroid light curves. And he had a nice routine in there that did the proper astrometry and reporting that actually got us our W66 observatory code, Minor Planet. So in 2012, Carl Rico convinced the editor of Astronomy Magazine that his readership would be interested in learning about an observatory that was powered by solar energy. Now, really, all that meant is putting an additional circuit breaker, but they didn't know that, so they decided they wanted the article. So in April of 2014, we got published. Emily and I wrote an article about the observatory and development, and you can see some of the images we used actually in this talk. So in terms of future observatory plans, the field site was laid out to accommodate a much larger domed observatory, which might end up being a retirement project for me. In the meantime, my youngest daughter uses my airline passes and travels the world and haggles hardware dealers for different components that she would like to see used in the observatory. So I'm just going to really briefly go over our data process collection, because Emily's going to talk more about how it's actually used in some of our science projects. So we normally acquire a target list from MIT Wellesley or Lehigh. It's usually prioritized by rise, set times, and magnitude. It needs to be high enough in the sky so it's not high air mass. Standard data collection using a telescope, a camera, take multiple images of the target in our calibration frames, do a reduction, and then generate the light curves and do a model fit. And that's more of just a check to make sure that the data looks okay. And then we forward the information to MIT Wells or Lehigh, whoever was asking for it. So the Finger Lakes camera issued by MIT was really optimized for transits. So it's low resolution, it has a lot of noise, but the readout is really fast. I mean, a typical asteroid occultation might be 10 seconds. You can see even 1 second is very important in terms of getting good data. But when we went to try to do exoplanets, that noise level, I mean, the counts on the Finger Lakes were about 2,000 for the background. They're much too high. We just couldn't tease out the curves on the exoplanets. So we ended up purchasing an SFIG used camera, actually, from this group here. It was a camera that you guys had at UACNJ, and it's a Model ST8. It has a much better noise level. It's about in the 200s, and does a much better job in the Finger Lakes. So how do these cameras perform with the telescope? The Finger Lakes had an 11 arc minute field of view. We did it. We used both cameras at 2x2 binning. The image scale is 2.6 arcseconds per binning per pixel. So what does that mean? Most of our asteroid imaging are 60-second exposures. So 1 minute exposure is good down to a magnitude of 16 with a signal-to-noise ratio of 100. Signal-to-noise of 100 gives you about 0.01 magnitude precision, which is pretty about the minimum you want for asteroid-like curves. But not so much for exoplanet-like curves. So the SBIG has a 15 by 10 arc minute field of view, 1.2 arcseconds per pixel. The host stars for the exoplanets, especially the program that we're in, are pretty bright. They're between 8th and 12th magnitude, so with a 25-inch telescope, that could lead to some pretty short exposure times. So the exposure times are usually between 8 and 40 seconds. So, for example, an 8-second exposure for a host star of magnitude 10 will yield a signal-to-noise of 1,000, and 1,000 gives you millimag precision. We learned a couple of tricks on how to increase the signal-to-noise ratio. One of the problems we were having is that we were saturating the chip when we kept the stars focused, but when we defocused it, it actually spread the light over more pixels, and we were able to increase the signal-to-noise ratio that way. For imaging software, we use Maxim DL Pro. It outputs FITS images. I won't go over a whole lot of that because that's pretty basic. Standard calibration frames, the only difference here is that we actually use light panel flats in addition to the light box. Target frames, like I said before, when the objects are 30 degrees above the horizon. Sometimes the shape modeling researcher, he likes us to go down as low as 25 if it's a target of opportunity. Typical nightly run is 4 or 5 hours, whatever it takes for the object to be above 30 degrees. At the end of the night, we back up the data on a USB drive and deliver it to MIT, or the exoplanet data is emailed. This is the Canopus software. It's used for the asteroid reduction. Nice thing about the Canopus is that it does a Fourier fit to fold a light curve, and it calculates the rotation period. And the Astro Image J is used for the exoplanet reduction, and that has a nice, will make a nice bowl fit. I think you saw a little bit of the output on Mary Lou's slide. You'll see another one from us. And it does all the raw data calibration corrections in one pass, which is kind of nice. So Emily's going to talk about the second part, which is to talk about the science and our collaborations.
Can I ask a couple questions?
Yeah.
I have two. Within all DAS mounts, how do you deal with flats? Doesn't that affect calibration?
Yeah, the thing is the flats really only deal with the motes in the camera system, right? So from the camera on, it doesn't, anything that's not moving with the rotator, it doesn't compensate for.
What about the vignetting factor? Doesn't that rotate as camera rotates?
The vignetting, we have found that the part of the chip that we're looking at is this very central part, so there's not a whole lot of vignetting going on.
The chip is small enough that
it's yes, not yeah, it's okay. It's in the full illuminated field.
Right. The second question is the photovoltaic field. Do you see that effect seen from, you know, gets up really hot during the day in the summer, and then they keep off?
Oh, the solar panels?
No.
A couple things. First of all, they're in another field now. So the field we're in is is 500 feet away from the panels.
Oh, so you're far away.
Yeah, and they pretty much acclimate fairly quickly at night. So I never really noticed. I mean, I have the wood burner down the hill would be more of a problem when it was still on the roof than the solar panels. Yeah. Yep, question?
How do you find the right places to buy the telescope parts?
Where do you buy the telescope parts from?
Google.
Yeah. There's a lot of vendors out there. If you want to see like 99% of them in one place, go to NIF, because they're almost all there, including JMI. I don't know if JMI hasn't been there for the past couple of years, but he used to go there. But yeah, and then on the other end, you know, manufacturers or distributors like Orion have a lot of telescope parts. But yeah, you can go online and find most of them.
I don't get telescopes from stores. Our one, the lock broke for it to stay in one direction.
There's a lot of websites that actually review telescopes, and you can get a pretty good idea which ones are good and which ones to avoid just by doing a little bit of research.
Yeah, it wasn't on the web. It was at an actual store, the first one that we bought.
Yeah. Well, hopefully you'll have better luck with the next one. So we can do more questions after at the end. I'm going to let Emily continue on then.
All right. As you can tell, between Alan and my dad videoing in the center, it's pretty hard to make me embarrassed. But the second part of the talk will be about all our research and collaboration. And we'll start with the asteroid collaboration with MIT and Wellesley. And we'll move into the more recent exoplanet with Lehigh. Just a basic overview of an asteroid. The first was Ceres, discovered in 1801, followed by Pallas and Vesta. And there's currently over 600,000 known. The Minor Planet Center in Cambridge is the authority for verifying, and it uses observations like ours to determine the orbit characteristics and verify any discoveries. This is an example of frame-by-frame images that we see. And every time we give this talk, people discover more and more asteroids. So there's one here. There's one here. But this is just an example of how we stay on one field and we watch the asteroid move through. And that's how we're able to make our light curves. So more than 600,000 known, and the main asteroid belt is where most are located. The primary locations of all minor planets, the near-Earth asteroids, we have main belt asteroids. There's centaurs between Jupiter and Neptune, and the Kuiper belt is included in the trans-Neptunian objects, which are anything past Neptune and out to the Oort cloud. And 80% of minor planets are main belt or Kuiper belt. Some asteroid characteristics. The size range is pretty vast. The first discovered Ceres is 590 miles in diameter, and all are smaller than that. To give an example of just how large Ceres is compared to the rest, is the total mass of the main belt is about 4% of Earth's moon, and Ceres comprises about a third of the main belt's mass, so many are much smaller than even half a mile of the near Earth and main belt. And the four main structures are the loose rubble pile, a scattered kind of coherent rock, you have solid rock, and then you have solid chunks of metal. There are many different types of groups, but carbon, stony, and metallic being the three main. But we want to determine what can be studied from these points of light. And from the asteroid's brightness, now the asteroid's brightness depends on the sun-asteroid distance, the asteroid-Earth distance, described here. And from that, we can determine asteroid size, and we can also determine the asteroid's reflection coefficient, the albedo, which also correlates with the composition. Nearly all asteroids rotate, and they're typically a 4 to 10 hour rotation period. These rotations are due to numerous effects, and the main being conservation of momentum from the initial formation, impacts after initial formation, or something due to the Yorke effect, which is named after its discoverers, which have some crazy names. But it is torque due to the uneven heating and re-radiation of the sun against different geometric facets on the asteroid, which is typical of a radiometer. And KBOs are much too far away for the sun to have an effect for Yorke. So those typically are not seen to have this. Now, light curves are brightness of the photometry as a function of time. And a rotation period of the asteroid can be derived after using a typical night's data. And then multiple nights can be plotted to get a full 10-hour period, say that is a very large, long period for the particular asteroid. Now, light curves can be used to analyze to determine size and shape of the asteroids, and that's the shape modeling is something that we contribute to. And it can also be used to determine the presence of any satellites that asteroid may have, which is also something we contribute to with MIT. And they're typically called a rotating potato because of the way they have different surface geometries. They also have phases similar to the moon, so the apparent brightness depends on the degree of illumination, which is the phase. And the phase is indicated by the percentage of the surface which is illuminated by the sun. So if it is at full phase or opposition, this is when the asteroid is brightened up as it approaches position opposite of the sun to the Earth, from the Earth. And photometry during these phase changes provides information on optical and physical characteristics, which as it brightens up, you'll see more and more surface geometries, which can lead us to determine its albedo, its roughness or porosity, which could determine its structure. And the changing shape of the light curve during the increasing phase angle is what helps us determine the shape of the spin axis, which is what one of our researchers' main contribution is. We always wonder why are we studying these kind of things. And the main two reasons are to increase knowledge of the origin of the solar system and to determine the structure and the density of the asteroids. Specifically for structure and density, you can use the rotation period in Newton's laws to calculate the mass and density. And for example, a rubble pile grouping is just a loose grouping with a density of approximately 1. And a high density or rock-like is approximately 4, and Earth is approximately 3.5. And with the knowledge of the density, you can determine what could be important in an asteroid collision with Earth. And that could determine a countermeasure, gravity tractor pull, a nearby nuclear blast, or your painting effect, which if you have a loose rubble pile, you'll probably need to take different measures than if you had a metallic structure. And you can also fine-tune what percentage are single and what percentage are multi-body. So for example, here we have what looks to be a multi-body, not just an incident of two craters. And moving into the satellites, we have the binary asteroids. And the first discovered by the Galileo spacecraft are Ida, very small dactyl right here, which are part of the Coronis family, which our researcher studies. Over the past 2 decades since then, approximately 200 more have been determined to be binary or multi-body. And the revolution periods of the binary are typically between 10 and 20 hours. The discovery methods are with space probes, direct observing, or indirect measures such as creating a light curve as we do. Different formations of these binaries. You have collision disruption or tidal disruption, so impact smashes off an asteroid, fragments off an asteroid, or twin tidal disruption where a rubble pile gets too close to a larger and ends up being pulled apart. Both collision and tidal are not likely for KBOs because their orbit location is not crowded enough. We also have gravitational capture, where a smaller body becomes too close to a larger and isn't captured in its orbit. This is the least likely due to the necessity of slow relative velocities for a weak gravity to pull components in. There is also fissioning asteroid, which is a rubble pile spun up by the Yorke effect past its breaking point. So it gets to a specific spin hour where the rubble pile just cannot, the centrifugal force overcomes the gravity and the rubble pile completely comes apart. And then the small pieces stay in orbit with the main asteroid. Not all binaries can be explained in this rotational fission way. Europe is probably not efficient enough to spin up large size asteroids, and the trans-Neptunian objects are too distant for the sun to develop a significant thermal torque. Just to show the spin barrier, where they begin to fall apart, the lower boundary is about 2.2 hours for asteroids larger than 150 meters. So you can see there's none spinning up in that quadrant because they all have broken apart at the 2.2 hour point. And these are determined to be the rubble piles. To begin our collaboration efforts, we started off at MIT, Department of Earth, Atmospheric and Planetary Sciences, with the Planetary Astronomy Lab, which operates Wallace, where Alan was employed. We have, in the beginning, we started with asteroid and Pluto occultation timings, where a body passes between Earth and a star, causing the star to briefly be eclipsed. We oftentimes had A pulses, where it was not a quite full occultation, but a grazing occultation. These were only appearing 2 to 3 times a year when the shadow path crossed our area. So to fill in those giant time gaps, Michael Person, who we were working with for Pluto occultations, introduced us to David Polishuk and Steve Sliven, who David was doing binary asteroids with their fission theory with the Yorff effect, and Steve was working more closely with Wellesley College on his alignment of the Corus family and their shape modeling and spin vector. How we reported to both David and Steve is a continuous consecutive 60-second exposures were taken, plus the download time. And the total sequence, after having the flat fields and dark and bias run through, are how we plot our light curve. And these light curves are checked for quality and consistency using MPO Canopus before we forward to MIT to make sure we don't have any possible variant comparison stars or of the like. And our data and our light curves were used in conjunction with those collected from other observatories to contribute to the long periods. Specifically for the binaries, David used a special software that was able to combine our and 7 to 8 other contributors' data to make that long 15 to 30 hour period that is typical of a binary. And the light curve has features that are, the binaries have very common features that can be seen here in these plots. And to begin with, the satellite needs to be aligned with asteroid and Earth. So if you have the asteroid rotating around this way, you would never be able to see it. It needs to come up in front. And this deep V-shaped minima and the wide inverted U maxima is representing the eclipse or the occultation between the primary and secondary components. So that is very, very common among binaries. And our first binary curve was quite noisy, but it was very, very good variation and exposure interval. And we had a calculated period that was very similar to a published, so we didn't go right in the dark. We took something that had already been published. And at that time, we were using an earlier version of Astro Image Day, which we then replaced with MPO Canopus, which gives this kind of plot. And we got much better. We tweaked the auto-guiding system, as you heard earlier, and we're able to get our signal to noise down to have a much cleaner and tighter plot. And with these specific three nights on 1860, we submitted to Minor Planet Center's Asteroid Light Curve database, just to have something out there that says we can make a light curve. And we also used these three nights to get our W66 code. And this is kind of an interesting video to see. In 2013 spring, you had the QE2 flyby, which was determined to be a binary asteroid. We happened to be at MIT delivering data to David, and he said, run home and get this. So we knew it was going to be moving too fast, but we had to actually auto-guide on the asteroid. So we weren't going to get a light curve out of it because we would never have the same comparison stars throughout the full night. And at some point, we both ended up falling asleep for just a brief period of time, and the auto-guider mistook a star for the asteroid. And we lost it.
Oh dear.
But then we woke back up and we were okay. We resetted it. But just to give you an idea, that it was moving through, this was with the Finger Lakes camera, so this was the 11 arc minute field of view. It was moving through about an hour per field. So we fell asleep for about an hour, but we got it. Now moving on to the spin vector with Steve Sliven. You can see that asteroid collisions can form families, and the members are identified by having similar orbital properties. And this is valuable because all members are known to share the same age and the same history. So in the plot on the right, we have a plot of orbital inclinations versus the orbit size, and that identifies the families. And the small k here identifies the Coronis family, which is among the most populous. And with enough light curves from different viewing aspects and over a long enough time span, it's possible to deduce the spin axis orientation in space, the direction of the spin, and you can create with a 3D printer a convex hull, as it's called, with the coarse model of the shape. So for example, here we have two light curves recorded about a year apart, but from 90 degrees apart in the ecliptic latitude. So in 1990, the light curve was brighter overall, as well as lower in amplitude than the 1989 curve, which indicates that the viewing aspect in 89 was closer to equator on than in 90, which was closer to the pole on. So with different, which for example here we had, this is our 1990 and this is our 89 degree change here. So from having every single aspect, you can create these kind of 3D shapes where, this is actually Ida and Dapko here, where they were able to verify what they looked like. And this is the same exact, this is the car that you just saw. So the study of 10 Cronus family members through a 9-year period revealed the marked clustering of spin periods and a spin vector. And this led to the discovery of the Orp effect, which modifies the asteroid spins, as we just discussed. And Cronus members' light curves, observations and spin and shape determinations are still ongoing. As we were able to get more aspect ratios, we were able to fine-tune the small corners and geometric shapes. As part of our contribution to his Cronus family, we, in the first, submitted our first paper in the Minor Planet Journal in April of 2014. We didn't determine a shape, we weren't that great, but we were able to see over a five different nights that we had a very similar period, and the period was not previously published, so because we had five nights, Steve told us to go for it and publish a light curve period. Now we'll move into the exoplanet, which has really only started since I began at Lehigh in August. But as we probably all know, an exoplanet is an extrasolar planet, a planet around a star other than our sun. There are many exoplanet detection programs. There's ground-based, which includes the Cal Lehigh team and your AAI team. And there's many space-based, including Kepler and others. The primary detection methods for an exoplanet, you have the radio velocity method, the transit method, which is used by Kepler and used by CAL programs. The other methods include direct imaging and gravitational microlensing. And the current exoplanet count is in the thousands and is increasing almost daily. To expand on the KELP transit method, the exocrypts come in many different shapes depending on the star, planet, Earth alignment, which you can see here. The different, how big the size comparison between the star and the planet and also its location towards the middle of the star. That's where you get the bowl type aspect. And you can determine exoplanet density if you measure the predicted ingress-egress time. And you can get the planet size. And then you can use mass and orbital period from radial velocity measurements to determine density. Exoplanet research includes many interesting possibilities. The transit method makes it possible to study the atmosphere of a transiting planet. So if you see in these type graphs, you would see an atmosphere would not quite so sharply dip down. It would come more of a slope. So that is one way you can determine an atmosphere of the transiting planet. And during the transit, light from the star passes through the upper atmosphere. So that's where you would see the slope down. Going into the KELP definition of the KELP program, it's a kilodegree extremely little telescope, and they have a KELP north and a KELP south, one being in Arizona, one being in South Africa, and both are operated through Lehigh, so that's how I was able to get some information about it through Professor Josh Pepper there, who is an astronomy professor. They are identical instruments. 4.5 centimeter aperture, so much different than what Alan and I and you all might be used to. They have a 26 by 26 degree field of view, we'll go to this first. These are just the fields observed by KELP, where the KS is denoted by being a Celt South, and KN is being denoted as being a Celt North. The survey frames cover about 62% of the sky. And to get an idea of that, 26 by 26, this is the Andromeda Galaxy, and it's 23 seconds by 23 seconds per pixel. And this is just kind of the area of discovery for Celt so far. It's all the exoplanets they've discovered through the transit method have been between about 9 and 12 magnitude. And their very first was not, it's also not ours, this is a Celt program. Exoplanet, it's not really actually an exoplanet, but an early discovery, it is the same, was Celt 1b. And it's a transiting one brown dwarf. But it gives a good example of just how the dip and the bowl works for the exoplanet. The status of the future of Celt, they have confirmed 10 and announced, confirmed and announced 10 exoplanets. And about 5 new exoplanets are in the stages of confirmation. And Celt transit detections cross over into many other research areas. Not many of these Lehi does not get into, but AI could possibly get into. This is just a map of all the Celt follow-up collaborators. And as Mary Lou mentioned earlier, candidates are confirmed or rejected based on data from a collaborative follow-up network, where they determine whether our bowl was deep enough and we had a good enough signal-to-noise ratio. Many of them are small colleges or amateurs with 10-inch to 32-inch scopes, and just a written-out version. The two of us are down here. We just made it. But there's many of them are colleges, Wellesley included, a different observer up there than we know. But so this is our first Celt submission. We were able to see an okay dip here. The predicted ingress and egress, after speaking to Professor Pepper, is actually a bit off. Not by our own undoing, but by just determining from other people's research that we might have been off the first time when it was published. So we've been getting much better data with our signal noise with the new camera. So further work for us, we still have a target list from MIT Wellesley that includes the seasonal Coronis targets and occasional occultation work. David Polishuk has moved back to WISE Observatory in Israel, so the binary work has essentially come to a halt, but otherwise, some binaries are actually Coronis family as well, but we just work with the Coronis spin axis side now. And you can use a transit finder on the Celt program, Celt project, to see where in your area you can, when they're out, when you can see anything. So we actually use the Celt South object, although we're in the north, but by using the Celt project finder, you can find anything you would like to observe. And this is just an image of a newer version of AstroMache that we've been using. And if we all have any questions, that would be it.
Any questions? I know we're running late, so I'm trying to keep this brief.
Just one quick question.
Yeah.
Right now, you're watching the planet pass in front of the star. If it's rotating around the other way, can you measure any changes in the perturbations of the planet?
If it's not lined up?
Yeah.
No, not indirectly. If you can directly image it, you can see it. But not indirectly.
I noticed on the Celt graphics a lot of the targets get sent to radial velocity work after they're more or less semi-confirmed. What kind of instruments are involved with that part of the confirmation?
Of the radial velocity?
Yes.
Yeah, that I don't know. We'd have to ask Professor Pepper, yeah, exactly where it goes with that. We're just at the point where we're just submitting the data now, kind of the way you guys are. So actually, that question that you had asked me earlier, probably one of the best things to do is if you go to star parties, you can actually learn a lot about the kind of equipment that people have and what can be used and what's better to use and what not use. Plus, you can try out different pieces of equipment that you might otherwise not buy if you didn't know any better. You know, so star parties are one of the best ways to find out what's the best equipment to buy. Yeah. Yes?
For UACNJ, Saturday nights between April 1st and October 31st, there's lots of telescopes set up in the field, and you can go and look at them.
Exactly. Exactly. All right. Thank you so much, then.